early bird special. We've got a couple extra little things planned for you, an opportunity for you to meet a couple of the great musicians who will be performing for you tonight, and also to meet one of our returning musicians as well. And following that, we have this incredible video that was put together by the Department of Defense, and it was a documentary about the Army Band, and we think it was maybe shot in the early 1970s. So those of you who are part of the Pershing's own family from years gone by, I'm sure we'll recognize a lot of folks in there, maybe see yourself up there. Then we'll be off to start this great concert. I'm Colonel Tom Pommetier, leader and commander of the Army Band. I'm also a Pershing's own alum here from 88 to 94, returned here in 2011. And in 2015, we'll once again become a band alum as I retire. I'm joined on stage by a couple of the great musicians who will be performing for you tonight, and they'll tell you a little bit about themselves.
Hi, I'm Staff Sergeant Megan Lomanoff. I play the flute. I've been in the band since 2007, and I'm from Oaklawn, Illinois. I actually spent my first 6 years in the ceremonial band, and just recently this year, switched over to the concert band. So I've had a variety of experiences, and I couldn't be happier.
I'm Staff Sergeant Benjamin Pattison. I've only been in the Army about a year and a half now, but I've had the pleasure of working with a lot of different ensembles here at Pershing Zone, including the Army Voices, the newest ensemble here for our unit, and the U.S. Army Chorus. We actually just got back from a TDY up to Philadelphia in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. What else was I going to say? I'm delighted to be here tonight and happy to answer any questions that you all have.
Hi, I'm Jack Tilbury. I was in the Army Band for 33 years. I joined in 1972. I'm a tuba player. And I retired in 2005 as the enlisted leader of this organization, which was a real honor for me. I had a very enjoyable career. I played in the ceremonial band and the concert band and in the Army Brass Quintet. But if you stay in this organization for any length of time, you end up eventually working with everybody, and that is a real treat because the level of professionalship, of musicianship, and the professionalism is quite amazing.
Well, the soldiers here, in addition to being incredible world-class musicians, also had developed all kinds of other talents and hobbies and things like that, They don't know that I'm going to do this. So Sergeant Lomanoff has actually gotten all kinds of medals and gold medals and this and that and prizes for a rather unusual hobby, somewhat unrelated to playing flute and piccolo, so she can tell you about that.
Oh, now I'm embarrassed. I'm very proud of it. In 2009, I started jiu-jitsu, which is grappling. It's like wrestling with, you might see it in the UFC with the joint locks and chokes, and it does relate to the Army because it's what the level one modern Army combatives is based on. And I've gone and done this training heavily on the civilian side and competed all over the world from California to Abu Dhabi, and I've had amazing experiences, and just this year I've won the Pan American Championship at Purple Belt, and hopefully that this will be the next big thing that I do and get to Black Belt.
So be sure to applaud any flute solos tonight, I can assure you. And as Sergeant Pattison said, he's a member of the chorus, but is also part of Army Voices, so maybe he can share with people maybe who don't know what Army Voices is a little bit about that group.
I originally, like I said, auditioned to be a part of the U.S. Army Chorus, but had the unique privilege of getting to sing some with the newest ensemble, the Army Voices, which is, I believe, a 12-part, is that right, sir? Vocal ensemble of mixed voices, so male and female vocalists, doing a whole wide variety of certain genres across different eras and appealing to all different sorts of audiences, which is a really neat thing to do. Some of my favorite things that Army Voices gets to do is there's a lot of educational outreach that comes with that ensemble, and a lot of the times of educational inreach, where a group will come to Brucker Hall here, and we'll get to perform for them and adjudicate a little bit, and really connecting with those younger audiences, sometimes with things from, if you've heard of the group, the Pentatonics, which is a five-part a cappella group. The Army Voices does a cover of one of their songs. But everywhere from Brahms' Liebeslieder to opera choruses and hits from Broadway, like Rent and things like that. So it's a great ensemble to keep your repertoire diversified and get a different blend than you would necessarily in the chorus, which is a four-part men's vocal ensemble, a little bit larger. So the Army Voice is a more chamber group focused on a lot of interesting blending and tone that you get in an ensemble that small. And it's just been a real pleasure doing a lot more performing with the band in unique ways. We just, when we went on the TDY to Philadelphia and Lancaster, we did a Beatles medley, which was a lot of fun, a Glenn Miller medley. So a lot of interesting things that can all get mashed together and spread between diverse voices that can then come together to form a really unique sound. And I look forward to performing with Army Voices more in the future.
Well, Sergeant Major Tilbury mentioned that he was the enlisted leader, and that's what our senior enlisted person was called for many, many years until not too many years ago we were privileged to be authorized to have a Command Sergeant Major. And on Monday, we'll have a change of Command Sergeant Major as Command Sergeant Major Mitchell Spray will turn over his responsibility to Sergeant Major Dan Smith, who will become the fourth Command Sergeant Major. But the job is probably pretty similar to what Sergeant Major Tilbury did. So maybe share some thoughts about what it was like for you to go from being a full-time musician to being also the unit enlisted leader, and maybe they can compare it to the way it is today. So.
Well, like I said, it was certainly a big honor to do that job, and having been here, you'd think it'd be a horrible job, and I guess it is in some ways, but having been here for as long as I had, by the time I got to do it, I kind of had it figured out, you know, and I kind of knew what to do, and I knew what not to do. You're sort of like the assistant principal at a high school. You get all the bad things, usually. And at least in my case, most of the things that would cross my desk really weren't any worse than a lot of the things I'd done earlier in my career. So that made it a little easier to say, oh, just how bad is this, you know, really? But I really enjoyed it a lot. The biggest thrill of that job was every once in a while you got to conduct the band. And as a musician, you used to stand out in front of that band, and even if you're just conducting a march, and even if it's just out on the parade field, it is a rush. And as a tuba player, you know, you're always in the back of the band, so you don't really hear what it sounds like. All you get is, hey, tubas, you're too loud all the time. So you know, to stand out there in front of the band and conduct it and hear it up close and personal like that was for me a real thrill. But it was an interesting job. It's not like they've brought in somebody from the outside to do it. The enlisted leader is always somebody promoted from within. So you know everybody already. You know what the problems are. You know the people. And you know what the people, you know what the people in the band are looking for, what they need, what their problems are, and you try to help solve them. And I assume that probably hasn't changed at all. It's certainly a more prestigious job now to be a Command Sergeant Major, and it's a good thing for the organization. It's something that the band had been trying to do since at least the early 70s, and it took that long for it to happen. Colonel Palmentier actually was one of the people involved in making that happen. The Sergeant Major of the Army is the one that ultimately did it, but a lot of the groundwork was actually laid by Colonel Palmentier while you were still at the field band, I think. You're at the School of Music at the time. And so that was a huge thing for the unit, and I didn't realize until we started looking back just how long we had tried to get that CSM status, and it was a huge deal for us.
Well, we've got just a few minutes before the video plays, so anybody have any questions or, you know, anything? Yeah, please.
Last summer, I think you heard something about a new music building.
Yes, it is still in the works. Actually, we have some good news, because last year, this Rucker Hall was built in the 1970s, and it was built by a low bidder in the 1970s. So, I mean, and we're very lucky to have it, but we're becoming less and less lucky as years go by. It's a kind of a miracle that the air conditioning is working tonight. It's one of the 3 days in the year that it's working, so you should be happy about that. Last year at this time, the proposal for a new band facility had been canceled and pushed off into the far, far distant future. Right now, it is considered approved for the year 2017, so in the year 2018, we should be moving into a new facility just down the street by the PX, and it will be much, much larger, and instead of a 350-seat hall like this with the seats down below, it's going to have a 750-seat concert hall with the stage down below and raked seating like every other concert hall in the world. And each of the ensembles will have their own performance space so that we don't have to have people constantly setting up and tearing down and setting up and tearing down. It will be spectacular and a huge, huge benefit to all of us. So we've got our fingers crossed. So I hope when I come back to an alumni concert in 2018, it will be in the new Army Band facility. Great question, thanks. Any other questions for us? Well, probably not, because all of you have probably been associated with Pershing Zone for all these years, so you know more about it than we do. So thank you so much for your attention. We're going to vacate the stage, and then we're going to watch a little video. Then we'll have the band and chorus take the stage, and promptly at 8 o'clock, we're going to start a really great concert. So thanks so much for being here.
The third special band is the United States Army Band and Chorus, based at Fort Myer in Arlington, Virginia. In 1922, General John J. Pershing, never a man to waste words, sent an order to a Captain Perry Lewis. It read, "You will organize and equip the Army Band." Not surprisingly, Captain Lewis promptly complied. And the band, bearing the name Pershing's Own, is still hard at work. Its primary assignment? To support the Army's ceremonial mission in the nation's capital. The Army Band's mission, as with the Navy, Air Force, and Marine bands, includes scores of appearances each year to provide music for parades and reviews, which are part of retirement ceremonies for senior leaders or the awarding of major military medals. Herald trumpets of the United States Army Band are frequently called upon to provide welcoming music for the arrival of important visitors to the White House, as well as to appear with the band in concert. Each Friday evening throughout the summer, the band performs at the East Plaza of the Capitol Building. ¶¶ hundreds of thousands of visitors and residents enjoy these Friday concerts. Concerts at the Watergate have been a regular feature of the Army Band's program for many years. With our glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. Samba duties are part of the band's day-to-day schedule as well. The band is called upon to provide music to honor departed comrades in arms at military funeral services. This may include a band group, or it may, as often happens, involve only a bugler to provide the haunting strains of taps. Whatever the assignment, day or night, weekday or weekend, large group or small, the overall total of performances by this organization runs to more than 4,000 each year. Throughout the Army and around the world, Army musicians continue to play the important role that their fellow artists in uniform have played throughout our military history, to bring to the soldier, wherever he is, music for his ceremonies and parades, and for his moments of leisure as well, to speak to his allies in the language that needs no translation. This, then, is the soldier musician. He goes wherever the Army's commitment takes him and does what he is uniquely qualified to do. This is their job, and this is what they're like, the Army's Music Man.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Brucker Hall here at historic Joint Base Fort Myer Henderson Hall. I'm Staff Sergeant Jesse Neese, and on behalf of all members of Pershing Zone, both past and present, I welcome you to our 2014 Alumni Concert. At this time, please welcome to the stage the leader and commander of the United States Army Band Pershing Zone, Colonel Thomas Paul Mateer. Been the premier musical representatives of America's Army. Through music, they've shared the story of our nation and its soldiers worldwide. We welcome you to this performance on behalf of all of the men and women of today's Army, for they are the strength of the nation, ready today and prepared for tomorrow. Please stand and join us in the singing of our national anthem. Please be seated. At this time, we're going to pass the conducting baton on to one of our conductor alumnus, Lieutenant Colonel retired Dave Dietrich, who is with us from 1972 until he retired in 2002. Colonel Dietrich's military career is rather unique in that he began as an enlisted euphonium player with the field band, then he became a warrant officer, and finally received his commission to become an officer and to conduct the ceremonial band and the Herald Trumpets while he was with us here at Pershing Zone. He will lead the band in a piece that's become a standard of the orchestral repertoire and, of course, concert band as well. Please welcome Lieutenant Colonel retired Dave Dietrich to conduct Dmitri Shostakovich's Festive Overture.
Thank you.
One of the best parts of alumni events, besides spending time with old friends, is discovering the many amazing things that people do after their Army career has finished. Our next soloist, for instance, after completing a 21-year career here with the Army Band, has worked as an associate professor of trombone and euphonium at the University of Memphis since 2001. During his Army career, he was the euphonium section leader and somehow found time to solo with many of our local symphony orchestras, as well as complete a DMA from Catholic University. He'll be performing a very well-known euphonium solo in the form of theme and variation, based on the ever-familiar Funiculi Funicula. Here to play Napoli, please welcome Master Sergeant Retired John Mueller.
Thank you.
We're going to pass the baton to yet another conductor, but this one is not an alumni, at least not yet. Command Sergeant Major Mitch Spray, whose career in the Army has spanned 32 years, playing trombone, leading ceremonies as drum major, and finally, over the past 3 years, as Command Sergeant Major of the United States Army Band, is coming to a close. This year's alumni concerts will be his last performances as an active duty soldier as he is retiring. Of course, we look forward to many years to come of alumni concerts where we hope he'll join us again here on stage. Here to conduct one of Pershing's own favorite marches, the Blackjack March, is one of our favorite Command Sergeant Majors, Mitch Spray. Over the years, the many ensembles of Pershing's Own have evolved and changed to reflect the changes of our society and, of course, changes in musical preference. In the early 70s, as a result of the women's rights movement, the first women were finally welcomed into the Army Band. Here to introduce the next piece is a wonderful soprano who joined the band to sing with the chamber singers as our first African-American female singer. After completing her enlistment with the Army Band from 1978 until 1981, her international career has included the opera roles of Aida, Tosca, Madame Butterfly, and both Bess and Serena in Porgy and Bess. Please join me in welcoming Elizabeth Lyra Ross.
Thank you so much. And thank all of you for coming out this evening and going through the rain. I want to introduce the piece that I'm going to do because it is really important to me, and I first sang it here with the Army Band and Chorus. In 1981, President Reagan gave Eubie Blake the Presidential Medal of Freedom. And as a result of that, we did a concert with Mr. Blake on the Capitol steps that was all his music, and we got to meet him. And he even played his famous song, Memories of You. I did some research to find out about Mr. Blake and just curious as to why he would receive the Medal of Freedom. And what it said on his award was that he had done service to the Army. And the service to the Army, which he did, was that during World War I and World War II and Korea, the Army was segregated. And what that meant in terms of entertainment was that the African-American soldiers were ineligible to attend the entertainments that were put on for the white soldiers. Mr. Blake spent his own money and brought bands over to Europe and the Far East to entertain the African-American soldiers and whomever else wanted to come. The piece that we're going to do is from a Broadway show called Shuffle Along. And it opened on Broadway in 1921, and it was the first show composed by African-American composers to open on Broadway. And this song was also the first song by an African-American composer to be used as a United States presidential campaign song. It was used by Harry Truman. Now, we're going to do two versions. It was originally written as a slow waltz, and that was the way it first appeared in the show, and it wasn't so successful. And so the woman who was singing I'm Just Wild About Harry in the show asked Mr. Blake to change it around, which he did. And so we're going to do both versions, and you can decide which one you like best. This is I'm Just Wild About Harry. Just one fellow for me in this world, Harry's his name, that's what I claim. For every fellow there must be a girl. I found my mate by kindness of fate. About Harry, and Harry's wild about me. The heavenly bliss of his kisses fill me with ecstasy. He's sweet like chocolate candy, and just like honey from the bee.
Chocolate candy, and just like honey from the bee. Ooh.
Lux Aurumque, or Light of Gold, by Eric Whitacre. We honor the alumni of Pershing Zone who in 2013 have passed away. The composer writes in the printed score, "If the tight harmonies are carefully tuned and balanced, they will shimmer and glow, as does the memories of our fallen friends." Here to read the names of the deceased is the president of the Alumni Association, Master Sergeant Retired John Taylor.
Trumpet, the Army Blues. Andrew Chofi, clarinet, the Concert Band. Command Sergeant Major Ross Morgan, tuba, Concert Band. Dave Wilkinson, trumpet, the Ceremonial Band. Milton Blaylock, Concert Band. Frederick Davenport Hollis, tuba, Concert Band. John Rhodes, tenor, the Army Chorus. Gino Mezzapelli, clarinet, the Concert Band. Joseph Wilcox Jenkins, chorus and arranger. John Kakavas, chorus and arranger.
Imagine with me, if you will, for a moment. It's summer vacation, a break from reality. You're spending your time on the shores of Rhode Island. The smell of salt air and the taste of clam cakes and clam chowder. And the sights and sounds that fill your senses are of a seaside amusement park, complete with roller coasters, the log flume, the merry-go-round, the Ferris wheel. And you make your way from ride to ride and from kettle corn to ice cream, holding hands and making memories. This is what inspired American composer Ron Nelson to write our next piece, Rocky Point Holiday.
Thank you.
Before we go on with our program, we have a special announcement. If there is a Robert Oddmark in the audience, if you could please make your way to the lobby to find a Sergeant Ketchum. I believe there was maybe a mix-up with an ID at the front gate. Robert Oddmark? But we found him. I believe there was an ID card mixed up at the front gate. If you could make your way to the lobby, there's an MP that wants to
save your chair,
settle the score.
Unless they take you away in cuffs.
It's always exciting here. Okay, on with the show. Musician, lead trumpeter, soloist, band manager, recording artist. These are just some of the titles our next soloist has held since leaving the Army Band. Since his discharge, he has performed as lead trumpet and as a soloist with many of the top bands in America, Woody Herman, Count Basie, as well as backing up notables like Frank Sinatra, Ella Fitzgerald, Tony Bennett, and Mel Torme, to name a few. Needless to say, his resume is impressive. During his tenure with the Army Band from 1970 to 1973, he played with the Blues and the Herald Trumpets, and this next piece was written for him by Ron Hickey. Here to wow us on the trumpet with a piece called Beyond the Limits, please welcome Dave Stahl. It's my pleasure to introduce for you now one of the most recent alumni of the Army Chorus, Ian Lane. As a second tenor, Ian sang with the chorus from 1999 until 2012. In the short time since he's left us, Ian has enjoyed performing the roles of Dave in The Full Monty. He covered Valjean of Les Miserables, and he'll be in the upcoming production of Spamalot singing Sir Bedivere with the Riverside Dinner Theater in Fredericksburg, Virginia. That was a shameless plug. Tonight, Ian will sing one of his signature songs that he sang with the chorus. It's a wonderful, inspirational song that was made famous by Josh Groban, titled You Raise Me Up. And we'll follow that with the signature song of the Army Chorus, and that, of course, will be the Battle Hymn of the Republic.
They've done that a couple times. but it just gets better and better. Well, we're so appreciative to see all of you here tonight, and also to be joined by the many, many people watching the live webcast through www.usarmyband.com. Now, you're probably thinking to yourself, this is such a great concert. I'd love to hear it again. Well, you're in luck. We're going to do it tomorrow night at 8 o'clock on the steps of the U.S. Capitol. But you're saying to yourself, oh, only once more? What I'd really like is to be able to watch it every single night for the rest of my life. Well, sometime tomorrow, it will post on YouTube in HD, so you can even go to the little gear and bump it up to HD, so you can watch this every night. You can, like, get rid of cable. Tell you what, quit your job. Just sit there and watch this concert over and over and over. Well, if you're visiting our website, we'd love for you to click the button that says Patron Survey, tell us what you thought about this concert. Join the email list, but we'd love for you to join us at any of the thousands and thousands of performances put on by the men and women of Pershing Zone throughout the year. And these alumni here in the audience, on stage, and many here in the audience are part of our history, and we're so pleased and proud to have them back here with us. And so we come to the part of the program that we've enjoyed for many, many, many years. It's our favorite part of the program, and no, it's not because it's near the end. It's because we get to pay tribute to you. We're going to perform the songs of the armed services, and we're going to do that in this order. We're going to do Coast Guard first, and then Air Force, and then Navy, and then Marine Corps, and then the senior service, the United States Army. And if you or a loved one served in any one of those services, we would love for you to stand when that song is played. And we do want families to stand as well, because they also serve. And if the passage of time or the wounds of the battlefield make it difficult for you to stand, don't worry about it. Just give us a good wave of your hand when you hear that song played, and we'll see you. Indeed, all of America will see you, because this is your Armed Forces Salute. Yeah.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience. We're going to close our program this evening with the official National March of the United States of America, which was written by John Philip Sousa and is most certainly a requirement of any summer performance by the United States Army Band Pershing's own. The Stars and Stripes forever.
While the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance to a land that's free.
Let us all be grateful for a land so fair as we raise our voices in this solemn prayer. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above.
From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
All right, all you proud Americans, please stand and join us in one chorus of this great patriotic song.
Thank you.